Dear students, I'd like to make a short summary of the fourth chapter in your textbook, Theories of International Relations. The chapter is about postcolonialism. After reading and studying this chapter, you'll be able to explain the basic concepts of postcolonialist theory, differentiate between the Orientalist perspectives and the arguments of Orientalism, explain decolonization processes, neocolonialism and postcolonialism, discuss the theoretical and epistemological approaches of postcolonial theory, and define the meaning and scope of the criticism against postcolonial studies in international relations. There is an important debate in international relations discipline. This is the one between the critical, postmodern, post-positivist, reflectivist theories and those of more rationalist, traditional and positivist theories. So postcolonial theory is among this critical, reflectivist group of post-structuralist and post-positivist theories makes a strong challenge and criticism of the Western world due to their colonies in Asia and Africa and the worldview that has not changed since then. Modernism is defined as the universality of the knowledge. So a modernist way of thinking coincides also with capitalism, the modern nation-state system, modern societies, modern powers, and modern relations, as opposed to developing countries that they need to take as a model to develop and to make progress. And colonization is the takeover of a territory and appropriation of the material resources in that geography, so the exploitation of labor, the raw materials, and interference with the political structure and cultural structures in that country, in that territory. So capitalism as an global type of economic production is also defined as imperialism in the global system. Edward Said has defined Orientalism as an amalgam of the attitudes and perspectives of Western scholars who call themselves Orientalists to legitimize the colonial aggression by the intellectually marginalized and dominated Eastern peoples. So there is the formation of a contradiction in this course. As post-structuralist scholar Michel Foucault has stated, between Occident and Orient. So there is a type of stereotype here, the rational Westerner and the irrational Oriental. So there is also a hierarchy in this contradiction, in this dichotomy. If we have a look at the basic arguments of the postcolonialist theory in international relations, first of all, there is a critical thinking, there is a criticism against the modern and colonial imperial world, and there is a new type of colonialism as defined any and all forms of control of the ex-colonies, even after their political independence, where the new elites have also been educated and trained by the colonialist powers. And there is a strong emphasis on the need for resistance in culture, language, psychology, and ideology. So the discourse is interwoven. As Michel Foucault has stated, there is always relation between power and knowledge. So this oppression is constituted in the social relations, and it serves to marginalize and silence and oppress the underdeveloped and developing nations. The Western thought is based on some dichotomies such as being and absence, identity and difference, domestic and international. So one cannot be understood without the other. So this necessitates a deconstruction of the texts and the meanings, as Jacques Derrida, again another post-structuralist scholar, has put forth. So these dichotomies also reflect a hierarchy. Deconstruction of the tasks is required for being able to see these value-laden terms and understand what is behind, what is between the lines. So the main scholars of postcolonialism all emphasize the deconstruction of the modern knowledge based on Western ideology and Western culture ideas, and the defense of the other, the people that are marginalized by the Western Enlightenment. If we have a look at the scholars in the postcolonialism, Fanon, for example, has studied the racism in the colonial oppression, so the psychological and intellectual transformation, how to achieve individual freedom. Albert Memmi has studied the exclusion from the colonizer and the colonized. Amy Cesar, pseudo-humanism, colonialist with a fake understanding of humanity, so the indigenous people, and how they are alienated even to their own culture, even being ashamed of being black. Another prominent scholar of the school is Spivak, a feminist writer, and has studied the subaltern tradition in India. She has a feminist look in post-colonialism. So she tries to define why subaltern cannot speak. They cannot speak because they do not have their own history, and also because of the sati tradition, sati culture. Here Spivak makes an analogy, the Hindu widow women's tradition of self-killing after husband's death. The analogy is between the Westerners as symbolizing men and the subaltern sati symbolizing women. Haba has also studied colonialism, but sees it as an opportunity for a cultural exchange between the Westerners and the Orientalists so that the subalterns speak for themselves as a mimicry only, and the speech is hybrid between the colonial cultures and their indigenous identities. So that's a reproduction of oneself. Besides these different views, challenging ideas of the postcolonialist scholars, there are also some criticisms against postcolonialism. The first one is that colonialism continues and survives, irrelevant with the prefix post. And the liberation of the colonies has happened only in terms of politics, political liberation, but not in economic terms at all. And the developing countries that are influenced from the Western culture with globalism spreading all through the internet. So it's very difficult to get rid of this influence. And that the differences between the people living in underdeveloped countries and the immigrants in the third world countries in the metropolitan countries causes an hybridity. And that the post-colonial scholars have unfortunately a blind eye toward the most stressed subjects who represent purely colonized people in the third world. That the other way around, the people living in the metropolitan countries also need to be studied. This is also among the criticisms vis-à-vis the post-colonial scholars.